مرحبا، معكم دكتور إبراهيم دبوس. اليوم راح نكمل المحاضرة السادسة من محاضرات لاب البيدياتريك للسنة الرابعة. باللابات السابقة حكينا عن how we can do treatment plan، شرحنا بشكل عام عن المانجمنت للبيدياتريك بيشنت بتسلسل. التسلسل كان بالبداية بالبريفنشن، بعدين الأوبراتيف، بعدين السيرجيكال، بعدين السبيس مينتينرز. بالنسبة للأوبراتيف في محاضرة الدنتال كيرز حكينا how we can manage dental cases and after we diagnose it. In some cases we may see a deep callus lesion that may involve the bulb. At this lecture we will talk about deep callus lesions in primary teeth that may affect the dental the bulb in the bulb tissue. بداية ضروري نميز إنه ممكن يكون في عنا deep callus lesions في primary and permanent teeth. حتى ال permanent we may face mature and immature permanent teeth. Mature means that the root is completely formed, and immature means that the root is not completely formed. And this means that we have open apex for these teeth. هلا بالبداية في حالات الـ small callus lesions الـ management ما بتختلف for primary and permanent. We can do filling. إذا كان الـ deep callus very deep في الـ primary teeth and reaching the bulb, we can do different procedure. We can do a liner if it's very deep and reaching the bulb without doing exposure. We can do indirect bulb capping. If we have a exposure, we can do a procedure called bulbotomy. In some cases, we can do direct bulb capping, but it's not preferred for primary teeth to do direct bulb capping. We can do directly coronal bulb removal. This is called bulbotomy. We will explain it later in this lecture. And if the bulb is completely inflamed and necrotic, we can do a procedure called bulbectomy, during which all the bulb tissue is necrotic or inflamed. While in permanent teeth, if we have deep callus lesion and there's an callus tissue, we can do callus tissue covering the bulb. We can do indirect bulb capping. If it is reaching the bulb and the bulb exposure occur, we can do direct bulb capping. If the bulb exposed in a big exposure and the bleeding is excessive, we can do a procedure called Schwick bulbotomy, during which we remove a small amount of the bulb. If it's more inflamed more, we can remove all the coronal bulb and it's called cervical bulbotomy. And if the inflammation reaching all the bulb, we should do RCT, root canal treatment. And the difference between mature and immature, always in mature teeth we go ahead to root canal therapy, while in immature permanent teeth we always try to keep the vitality of the root in order to allow the root to be formed completely. This procedure called apexification, if the root is, if the radicular part of the bulb is necrotic, and called apexogenesis if the radicular part of the bulb is vital. Today in this lecture we will talk more about deep callus lesions in primary teeth. Before deciding what the ideal procedure to be done for deep callus lesions in primary or permanent teeth, the first point is start to collect data about the tooth in order to get the right diagnosis. Because the first step, or the most ideal step in treating a deep callus lesion, is the diagnosis. Firstly, we should get good history of the pain, because the history of the pain is the most important part in determining if we have a healthy bulb or inflamed bulb. For example, if we have a provoked pain by cold, by sweet, this means that we have reversible vulvitis, and we can try to preserve the vitality of the bulb. While if we have a spontaneous pain, this means that the bulbar tissue is severely inflamed and irreversibly inflamed, and this can be diagnosed more as irreversible vitis. At this stage, we can't deal with the bulb tissue as a healthy. But you should be careful that sometimes many kids may come to your clinic suffering from spontaneous pain due to food impaction in the class 2 cavity. That's why it's very important to do good history and examination for the area. The other step is clinical examination, during which we should look for the tooth itself. For example, the mobility, if you have large cavity, if you have defective or secondary or sensitivity to percussion. And the clinical examination should include palpation of the tooth by finger in order to find if it's sensitive to palpation or not, if you have swelling underneath the tooth, or if you have a draining perioles that indicate that the patient have a chronic abscess. Sometimes we may introduce vitality tests such as electric pulse testing and cold test and heat test, but for pediatric patients, this is not a reliable test. In addition to history and examination, the radiographic examination should include the periapical and intraocular area, and we should look for radiolucency of bone, because the presence of radiolucency in periapical and intraocular area indicate that the tooth have a necrotic bulb. In anterior primary teeth and permanent teeth, we should look in the periapical area, while in the posterior primary teeth, we should look for in the intraocular area, because we have the accessory canals in primary teeth is concentrated more in the bulbar floor. And you should look in the radiographs for pathological root resorption, because it can change your treatment plan, as we will say in the coming slide. And the last diagnostic tool is the operative diagnosis. Sometimes we can get the diagnosis after we open the bulb. If the quality of the blood, this means the color, and the amount of bleeding is excessive, this indicates that we have irreversible vulvitis. What we mean is, if the blood is excessive and the color of the blood is dark, this means that this tooth has irreversible vulvitis. While if the bleeding stop within a few minutes and the blood is pinkish, this means that the tooth is reverse, that the tooth has and then this means that we have healthy bulb tissue. And in sometimes we may see exudate, this means that we have abscess in the bulb tissue. The management of deep callous lesions include conservative bulb therapy and radical bulb therapy. Conservative, during which we try to maintain the vitality of the bulb, and radical, we remove whole the bulb and fill the bulbar space with the medicaments. If we have deep callous lesion, and by X-ray we can see a thick dentine layer between the callous lesion and the bulb, and after cleaning the callus, we have healthy dentine on the walls and in the bulbar floor. We can protect the deep dentine layer on the bulbar floor with the calcium hydroxide cement in order to protect the dentinal tubules because it's wide and permeable and may allow the entrance of filling part of the filling material and bacteria to the bulb by placing calcium hydroxide liner, and this on all the cavity covered by filling. This will protect the vitality of the bulb tissue. In other cases, after removing the caries, we may have a small amount of dentine or what we call carious dentine that cover the bulb. And if this carious dentine is removed, the bulb exposure may occur. At this stage, we can use indirect bulb tapping, during which we should clean the walls of the cavity and keep a small amount of caries on the bulbar floor. And the amount of caries that can be left is the amount that can, if it's removed, it will result in bulb exposure, during which we can cover the small carious lesion with calcium hydroxide cement or other materials such as MTA or glass enamel, and cover the tooth with permanent filling. At this stage, we don't need to re-enter the cavity. We call this indirect bulb capping. The aim of this procedure is to try to arrest the carious process and promote dentine formation, tertiary dentine formation in the bulbar side of the caries. And at this stage, remineralization will occur at the carious area. Sometimes, if the deep carious lesion is removed and we face bulb exposure, the most important thing is always try to keep the walls clean from caries. And if exposure occurs here in the primary teeth, we should go ahead to do a procedure called bulbotomy. But in permanent teeth, we can do a procedure called direct bulb capping, during which we cover the exposure site with calcium hydroxide cement or MTA or enamel derived proteins such as emdogain. This material will enhance the formation of tertiary dentine, and the dentinal bridge will be formed after a few months, and all the cavity will fill with permanent filling. It's very important that the exposure side should be limited to about 1 millimeter, and the cause that we don't do direct bulb capping in the primary teeth is that internal resorption will occur in primary teeth, while in permanent teeth the success rate of this procedure is high.
As we said, in the direct bulb capping, we can use direct bulb capping for carious exposure or traumatic exposure in permanent teeth, while in primary teeth, in case of carious exposure, we should use a bulbotomy procedure. Bulbotomy is a procedure during which we remove the infected coronal part of the bulb and keeping the radicular part of the bulb, which is healthy. And sometimes we keeping it intact without any interference, and sometimes we may put some medication that can change its condition. In cases where we have a contraindication of using bulbotomy, in case of a swelling due to necrosis of the bulb, or if we have fistula, which is also indication for necrosis of the bulb, and mobility, if the tooth has mobility and having a bone loss around the tooth, and in cases of external root resorption or internal root resorption of the bulb, and in cases if we have a radiograph interradicular lesion or periapical lesion in anterior primary teeth, we should not using bulbotomy. And if we have after exposing the bulb, as we said, sometimes we may have excessive bleeding of the bulb. In such case, we should considered bulbectomy, which we will explain it later in this lecture. And the aim of the bulbotomy procedure is to maintain the healthy radicular part of the bulb and removing the contaminated or infected coronal part of the bulb to allow the roots to resorb and exfoliate normally. The materials that we use, formic resol, we apply it for 5 minutes. We're using cotton billet. Ferric sulfate, we apply it for 15 seconds, and MTA by depositing a 1.5 millimeter thickness over the bulb stem.
The procedure of bulbotomy is in this way. As we said, if we have deep carious lesion, we clean the walls, then we start cleaning the bulbar floor. If bulb exposure occurred in the primary tooth, we decide doing a bulbotomy. The first step of bulbotomy is the removal of the bulbar roof, a procedure called deroofing. Then we remove the coronal part of the bulb, by means of round bare, low speed, large one, or excavator, sharp excavator. And after this, we can see from the orifices the healthy radicular bulb. At this stage, it's normal to see bleeding at this area. Then we put a cotton billet for a few minutes in order to get hemostasis to stop bleeding. After removing the cotton billet, we can use either a formiclozole cotton billet for 5 minutes, or using ferric sulfate 15 seconds after washing the cavity, the chamber here, or using MTA by filling it in the bulb chamber, as we will see in the next slide. After removal of the cotton billet, formiclozole cotton billet or ferric sulfate, after washing and drying it, we put a base from zinc oxide eugenol, then the permanent filling. It could be amalgam or stainless steel crown. Stainless steel crown always preferable. At this side, we see all the same steps. Here is removal, bulb exposure, deroofing, bulb chamber removal, coronal bulb tissue removed, half cotton billet for homeostasis. Then we apply the MTA, then a zinc oxide regional filling or glass enamel filling above the MTA, then the permanent filling, amalgam or stainless steel crown. This slide will show us the steps of treating deep carious lesion. Firstly, we have deep carious lesion. At the beginning, we should give local anesthesia because such cavities, the carious movement in this cavities is painful. We start with cleaning the caries from the wall. After cleaning the caries from the wall, we may have a remnant of carious lesion at the bulbar floor. At this stage, we can do indirect bulb capping in order to avoid doing bulb therapy for the tooth. But if an bulb exposure, as we said, occur here at this at the bulbar floor. At this stage, we should stop completing our procedure, and rubber dam isolation should be done in order to avoid contamination of the bulb tissue here. At this stage, we decide to do bulbotomy. Rubber dam should be used, as we said, in order to isolate the cavity. Then we start doing deroofing. We remove the roof of the bulb chamber. It's normal to see bleeding at this stage. Then we should remove the bulb tissue by means of excavator or round bear, low speed, big one, in order to remove the tissue tags in the area. Then we apply a damped cotton billet with water in order to stop bleeding for a few minutes. At this stage, we can see the bulb stamped here, the orifices of the bulb tissue. The bulb here is clean and no bleeding is can be seen. At this stage, we can use either formiclozole cotton bullet for 5 minutes or washing the cavity with ferric sulfate for 15 seconds or applying MTA 1.5 millimeter directly on the cavity. Here, after applying the formiclozole cotton bullet, we can see the fixation of the bulb stems. The color of the bulb stem became brown due to the fixation of formiclozole. And the effect of ferric sulfate also tried to do blood clot in the area. As we see, we can see blood clot here, 15 seconds of formiclozole. Apply MTA directly on the cavity. We can put 1.5 millimeter of MTA. We fill the cavity with the base zinc oxide eosinol. Slide revise the medicaments that can be used in bulbotomy. 15.5% ferric sulfate solution applied on the bulb stem with microbrush for 15 seconds in order to achieve homeostasis, followed by rinsing and drying the cavity. Or 20% buccal formiclozole solution applied to radicular bulb on a cotton bullet for 5 minutes to achieve superficial tissue fixation, or MTA applied upper radicular bulb with carrier. This is the IRM, the filling material after doing bulbotomy. This means that after removal of formiclozole cotton pellet and after washing the ferric sulfate and drying it, and after applying the MTA, we can use the IRM directly. The IRM is a powder and liquid. The powder is zinc oxide powder, and the liquid is eosinol that mixed in glass slab in order to form a thick filling material that fill the bulb chamber. Whether the medicament that used formiclozole, zinc oxide, formiclozole or ferric sulfate or MTA. This slide shows us the IRM in place. The bulb chamber is, as we said, treated with the medicament. Then we fill it with the IRM. The IRM first is placed in a small amount in order to be adapted in the bulb chamber, and they close the bulb stems. Then we apply a large amount of the MTA of the IRM in order to fill the cavity at all. The last procedure is bulbectomy. We consider it as radical because we remove all the vital tissue from the bulb. You use it in case when chronic inflammation or necrosis in the radicular bulb. The aim of this procedure is to maintain primary tooth till its exfoliation. The medication that can be used in the radicular bulb space is zinc oxide eosinol paste or calcium hydroxide uniform mixture. This radiograph shows us a periapical radiograph showing the lower left quadrant, the 3-6 here and 7-5, 7-4 and 3-4 and 3-5. We can see on the 7-5 deep carious lesion that exposing the bulb. After exposing the bulb, a bulb necrosis will occur on the coronal and radicular part. At this stage, we can do extraction for the E, but because we don't have erupted 6 yet, we try to keep this tooth by doing bulbectomy, during which access cavity was done, and checking the working length of the tooth of the roots. As the slide, we start doing the access cavity, check the working length for the roots separately, then filling the root canal with specific medication such as Vetipix or the zinc oxide agent based. This tooth we did bulbotomy, as we see here. We can see the filling on the bulb chamber and the healthy radicular bulb tissue. After doing bulb therapy for primary tooth, the ideal restoration is a stainless steel crown. This slide shows us the steps of doing stainless steel crown. Firstly, we should do occlusal reduction, 0.5 mm to 1 mm occlusal reduction. Then proximal opening, we should open the contact minimally. No need to remove too much amount of the proximal side. It's enough to allow the tapered pearl to pass in between. And try the stainless steel crown. It's very important to know that we have a specific stainless steel crown for the D's and the E's, and the sizes of the crowns ranging from size 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. For each tooth, we have a size that's written on the stainless steel itself. Here we can see the D with a stand for the tooth type, and 5 stand for the number. And this sign used the Palmer numbering system, showing the quadrant that from which this stainless steel crown can be inserted.